Assalamu alaikum students. So today our topic of discussion is gametogenesis, the conversion of germ cells into male and female gametes. So far we have covered the reproductive systems and anatomy of the reproductive systems, the male and the female reproductive systems. In this we know that the gametes of the male reproductive system are known as sperms, and they are produced in the male reproductive organ called the testes, and from here they enter into the system of ducts known as male genital ducts, epididymis, vas deferens, ejaculatory duct, and then the urethra, various parts of urethra, and then it comes out from here in the comes out from the urethra outside and deposited into the vagina of the female. Now from vagina of the female they are transported into the uterine cavity and then into the uterine tubes. Now the female reproductive organ, which is known as ovary, it from here ovulates the female gamete known as oocyte, or generally it is known as egg. So oocyte is released from the ovary, and the fimbrial end of the uterine tube, it enters the fimbrial end of the uterine tube. So, and by the action of movement of cilia present on the apical surface of the cells lining these oviducts or uterine ducts, the oocyte or the egg moves forward. The sperms are coming from that way and the egg is coming that way. So this is the ampullary region of the uterine tube, and here you can see the process of fertilization occurs. Now how these male gametes and female gametes, that is male gamete the sperm and female gamete the oocyte or the egg, is produced. These are produced from the cells known as primordial germ cells. So after fertilization, here you can see after fertilization the zygote is formed, and further development of zygote results in formation of two germ layers, that is the epiblast and the hypoblast. From this epiblast layer, all the three layers of the developing embryo, it develops. All the three germ layers of the developing embryo develops from the epiblast. It is derived from the epiblast. So some cells from the epiblast, some population of cells detach from the epiblast, these are known as primordial germ cells. Now the primordial germ cells from the epiblast, they migrate into the wall of the developing yolk sac here, and in the second week they migrate into the wall of the yolk sac in the second week. From here the primordial germ cells, they start migrating in the fourth week, and in the dorsal mesentery, here in the dorsal mesentery of hindgut, this is the hindgut, and they travel along the dorsal mesentery of the hindgut into the developing gonads. Now these developing gonads are the part of developing reproductive system, and these gonads will ultimately develop into male in case of XY genotype. They develop into testes, and in case of XX genotype they will develop into ovary, and the primordial germ cells arriving in these developing gonads will form the sperms in the testes, and oocyte or eggs in the ovaries. Now the so during the process of migration, the cells, they increase in number. These primordial germ cells, they increase in number, increase their number by mitotic division. And arriving in the these developing gonads, here the process of gametogenesis starts, and by the process of by the meiotic division. During gametogenesis, the primordial germ cells, they undergo certain changes that make them suitable for fertilization. The main objective of these changes is to reduce the number of chromosomes in each gamete from diploid to haploid. Diploid means the normal 46 chromosomes to haploid 23 chromosomes. This is achieved by meiosis. And in the male, the developing gametes also undergo a sequence of transformational changes, due to which the morphology of mature male gametes is greatly different from that of ordinary cells. Now, the basic pattern of gametogenesis is the same in the male and female, but there are some marked differences as well. The important difference which I discussed now is the timing of different stages of the gametogenesis. It is different in the two sexes. So this process of gametogenesis, it occurs by the process of by the meiotic division. While its number, the number of primordial germ cells, they increases by the mitotic division. So it is important, first of all, to study the salient features of mitosis and meiosis, because various chromosomal abnormalities can result in due to abnormal mitosis or the meiosis, meiotic process. So first of all, we will study the process of mitosis and then meiosis. So all of you know that our genes are located in the DNA, and the DNA in turn it is present in our nucleus in the form of chromatin, and then the chromosomes. The chromosomes is the condensed form of chromatin. So here you can see that this is the double helical structure of DNA, and in this DNA lies our genes. And due to folding of this DNA material, this DNA into structures, they condense. Ultimately, at the time of division, the chromosomes appear, and you can see here that this chromosome has got two alleles known as chromatids. These are known as sister chromatids, and they are joined here at the center by this point is known as centromere. Outside to this centromere lies a protein which bind this chromosome to the mitotic spindles, and this protein is known as now each chromosome, it consists of a short arm and a long arm and a region of constriction known as centromere. So this is a chromosome. Now prior to cell division, the chromosomes replicate, and then each of them consists of two chromatids. During cell division, the chromosomes can be visualized under light microscope. Careful inspection reveals that chromosomes exhibit different lengths and shapes. Each chromosome has a constricted region where two chromatids are held together. And this is the constricted region, and two chromatids, these are called sister chromatids, they are held together, and these are after the replication prior to the cell division. Now each chromosome, as I have told you, has got a long arm and a short arm, and the region, constricted region, also contains a protein known as kinetochore, which attaches the two centromeres as well as the mitotic spindles. Then So then what are homologous chromosomes? These are the pair of chromosomes, maternal or maternal and the paternal, that are similar in shape and size. Homologous pairs, that is, they are tetrads carrying genes controlling the same inherited traits. Each locus, that is position of gene, is in the same position on the homologus. Humans have got 23 pairs of homologous chromosomes, first 22 pairs of autosomes and last pair of sex chromosomes. So here you can see that these are the chromosomes, not homologous. These are the homologous chromosomes, and when their replication occurs, the two sister chromatids in one homologous chromosome and two sister chromatids in the other chromosome. So the homologous chromosomes, after replication of synthesis of DNA or replication, they have got tetrads chromatids, four chromatids. So homologous chromosomes, these are the homologous chromosomes, one maternal and one paternal, and they have got similar sets of genes, and when they get replicated, they have got four sister chromatids. So for your understanding, this is the karyotype, that is the mapping of the chromosomes, and this is the mapping of the normal human male, and you can see the 23 pairs of the chromosomes, 23 pairs, that is 46 chromosomes of the cell present in the nuclei. And this is the karyotype of the human sperm, and you can see the single haploid number, 23 chromosomes, 23 number of chromosomes, no pair of chromosomes are present, just single chromosomes, 23 chromosomes. So this is the haploid number of chromosomes, and this is called the diploid number of chromosomes. So we have 46 chromosomes, 23 pairs of chromosomes in the human, while only 23 chromosomes in the human sperm or the female gamete, that is the egg or oocyte. Okay, now mitosis. The process of mitosis, it is the process used by the somatic cells as well as the germ cells to increase their number. And mitosis is the process whereby one cell divides, giving rise to two daughter cells that are genetically identical to the parent cell. Each daughter cell receives the complete component of 46 chromosomes. Before a cell enters the mitosis, each chromosome replicates its DNA, its deoxyribonucleic acid, that is DNA. During this replication phase, the chromosomes are extremely long, and they are spread diffusely throughout the nucleus, and they cannot be recognized by the light microscope. With the onset of mitosis, the chromosomes begin to coil, contract and condense. These events mark the beginning of this prophase. And now even in this prophase, the chromosomes does not appear. The chromosomes, they do not appear under the light microscope. This is just a diagram to show the presence of the microscope. Chromosomes. Now throughout prophase, the chromosomes continue to condense, shorten and thicken, but only at prometaphase the chromatids, they become distinguishable. So in prophase, the chromosomes, they are not distinguishable, but they are condensing, they are coiling, condensing and thickening, and at the prometaphase they appear to be distinguishable. Now during the metaphase, now also in the prophase, you can see the centrioles, they divide and they are moving towards the opposite poles of the cell, dividing cell, and mitotic spindles are beginning to form. Now at metaphase, Now metaphase, at metaphase, during metaphase, the chromosomes lines up in the equatorial plane and their double structure is clearly visible now. Now this is the double structure, this is clearly visible, and they are arranged at the equatorial plate. And the mitotic spindles, they are binding to these chromosomes by the this constricted region, the centromere, by a protein known as kinetochore. This I have told you before. Now the during metaphase, the chromosomes line up in the equatorial plane and their double structure is clearly visible. Each is attached by microtubules extending from the centromere to the centriole, forming the mitotic spindle. Now this is attached by the kinetochore, protein kinetochore. Soon the centromere of each chromosome divides, making the beginning of anaphase. So centromere of each chromosome divides, and this marks the beginning of anaphase, and followed by migration of chromatids to the opposite pole of the spindle. Finally, during telophase, the chromosomes uncoil and lengthen. On the telophase, the chromosomes uncoil and lengthen, and the nuclear envelope, it reforms, and the cytoplasm divides in the this. The nuclear envelope reforms and the cytoplasm also divides, and each daughter cell receive half of the double chromosomal material, and thus maintains the same number of chromosomes as the mother cell.